If you think any investment is immune to insecurity, you are totally wrong. Welcome to Monday Money Moves. I'm Michael Abayomi, also known as Spring Boss, and of course, I'm the Group Managing Director, CEO, Asset and Equity Group, a leading investment banking institution in the heart of Lagos Island, Victoria Island, and other major cities of the world. So today, we are looking at insecurity and how it has been seen from various lenses. But I tell you, the clearest of all this is that nothing, and absolutely nothing, is immune to insecurity. Ultimately, insecurity makes all investments look speculative and totally unpredictable. From Europe to Asia, Africa, Australia, North America, South America, and all the way to Antarctica, the problem of insecurity is a unifying factor, as all countries in all continents, from the smallest to the giants in military and other arsenic assets, are faced and still facing serious insecurity challenges. Today, the world is being terrorized more than any time in its history. You have the Boko Haram sect in Nigeria and other West Africa countries. And then the US has the Al-Qaeda come the ISIS movement threats, okay? After 20 years of that 9/11 terror, the United States people have not gotten over the mental picture, even though the World Trade Center has been rebuilt and maybe a couple of other buildings around it. Another terrible insecurity issue is the Israel-Palestine crisis. The United Kingdom and the rest of Europe have been encountering suicide bombers issues. The South American region today faces the menace of drug trafficking, organized crime, terrorism, migration, and above all, the poverty level is outrageous. Asia is known for issues around territorial disputes. And as little as this might seem, until you wake up one day and you are told you now have to register afresh all your properties under a new government, that's where you know it's a big deal. We can go on and on listing all these challenges across, you know, the continent, but then we would rather focus more on productive issues, such as the rationale and causes of insecurity. First of all, I'm tempted to say that terrorism might just be the new colonization strategy. I say this especially because when you study the amount of financial and material needs required to form, run, and maintain a terrorist organization, you will understand that that is just too organized to be a sheer result of religious anger. I'm convinced that there might just be some unseen players with high-level sophistication being reflected in all of these crises, but you know, that's not the key focus of this discourse. The fact is, globalization is the end game for all markets. And if you look critically at this terrorism and all the terrorist mindset, you will understand clearly that they also seek to globalize their religious views and beliefs. So, who would you rather have in control, or say in charge, of a fully globalized market? This is a $1 trillion question for all busy entrepreneurs who pay little or no attention to security, or better still, to those business persons who believe security is solely meant for the government to handle. I tell you, government officials have humongous access to humongous resources and information, such that they suffer the least loss when there is a crisis. Dear business people, I want to ask you a few questions. Number one, how many politicians died in the September 11 terrorist attack in the US compared to civilians? Number two, how many politicians have died from the menace of Boko Haram insurgents compared to civilians? Number three, how many politicians have died in the Israel-Palestine crisis compared to civilians? Number four, how many politicians have died from the China border dispute compared to civilians? So you see, security is everybody's business. It's as simple as that. And then we have to now talk about solutions, okay? But then before we look at solutions, it is very, very important that we must first identify the resources that fuel the growth of insecurity. Number one, inequality. Inequality is just, you know, pointing straight to, you know, weak or lopsided wealth distribution. And if you look at it, research has it that half of the world's net wealth belong to top 1%. And I take that again, half of the world's net wealth belongs to the top 1% of the population of this world. Another thing is the top 10% of adults hold about 85%, while the bottom 90% hold the remaining 15% of the world's total wealth. So where are we? Another index is top 30% of adults hold 97% of total global wealth. So we can't call this distribution, like we can't, this kind of distribution, it's not even a distribution to start with. But then these are part of the key issues that lead to insecurity. When some people feel unequal to other people within the same societal context, then you give rise to all these issues of people giving themselves into terrorism, into terrible actions, and the rest of it. And number two, well-distributed industrialization, okay? When industrialization is not well-distributed, the result is insecurity. Now, I say this, okay? Every nation must move from being primary producer of primary goods and services, or let's say agricultural goods, raw materials. From that, they must move to proper industrialization where they are now venturing into the production of finished goods, or at the least, intermediate ones, okay? So the point is, until countries learn to export finished commodities to other countries, then there will be inequality in industrialization, and that will also fuel insecurity from nation to nation. And like the normal Nigerian saying, that if your neighbor is hungry, your chicken is not really safe. So talking about industrialization and how nations can move from being primitive or from being primary producers of primary goods or agricultural goods, raw materials and stuffs, to moving into mechanizing industrialization process, mechanization of industrial process or maybe business processes and the rest of it. So I say there are five factors of industrialization. Number one is natural resources. Okay, natural resources are, you know, natural endowment, you know, God-given assets onto many nations, like crude oil, like zinc, iron ore, bitumen, here and there. You know, most countries in Africa have, you know, large deposits of this endowment. Number two is capital. You need money, you need resources, you need a lot of that to ensure that, you know, you industrialize your nation. And that's why nations borrow. You see a nation having so much in debt, a lot of other countries borrow for infrastructural projects, and some countries borrow in the name of trying to industrialize, and then, you know, you still find out that because of some level of corruption, it doesn't really happen. So number three is the workforce, okay? You say the workers, okay? The workforce of any nation is one of the most valuable assets of that nation, especially in this knowledge-driven economy that is, you know, that is all over the world now. most people now have to maintain, to have some level of knowledge to be able to compete internationally or even globally. So another factor of industrialization is technology. You must just be technologically inclined to compete, to develop, because everything tends towards technology. And whatever repetitive process that exists in any business or any nation or any developmental process can be automated, can be structured in such a way that, it becomes faster to achieve. And the rest of it, another factor that contributes to industrialization is consumers. This points straight to the structure of the purchasing power parity. The value, the quality of the purchasing power parity of a nation, that is the power of citizens of any country to purchase certain kind of things. The power or the financial muscle for citizens of nations to be able to afford certain goods and services. And that would also more or less have an impact on the speed of industrialization in any country, because why do you have to produce finished goods when the population cannot afford what you're trying to produce? So it's also an impact. And then another one is transportation. You need to devise a means to move goods, services to market. So the gap between goods and market must be covered by proper transportation channels. And that is another factor of industrialization. Another very good factor that is the most paramount of all the factors is a cooperative government. A government cannot practice nepotism, tribalism, kinsmenism, racism, and expect that there will be development or wealth will be evenly distributed across that kind of nation. It's not just going to happen. It's an irony. How can you think that in this age and time you want to have a proper wealth distribution structure? You want the nation that is properly run, that is void of corruption, that gives citizens sense of belonging, that gives citizens the right to live in the country and not just want to escape, and not just want to run out of the country, okay? So there has to be some level of cooperation from the point of government, from the table of the government. The kinds of policies that will be coming out from the table of our government officials should be, based on equity and sound judgment. People must definitely do the right thing with one objective in mind: to better the lives of citizens and to protect the lives and properties of the citizens. So also, like I said earlier, policy environment must be enabling, relaxing, investment friendly, and relatively stable, so that, investment or even the country or the nation can thrive. So another thing that can help fight insecurity is education. So education basically can also be a weapon to fight insecurity by any serious nation. Generally, education must be duly developed, and product of an education system of a country must be well competitive with other products of organized institutions or universities in other countries. And that should be the standard. Another point that I would like to highlight here is the formal and the informal education. Okay, education is usually in two ways, generally believed to be in two ways, and that is the formal education and the informal education. It's high time we got over the issue of the university graduate with a degree in mechanical engineering, and a mechanic who has spent years also perfecting his skill as a mechanic. And in most cases, these ones who have gone strictly to learn the trade, to understand the skill, and not through the university system or through a higher institution education, they are even in most cases they are usually more handy. They usually come out even more knowledgeable in that practical space than people who have gone to study in the school system. But that system must
learn or must be restructured or must be adjusted such that informal education is not just discarded as a second grade education, because they are fundamental part of the economy, agents that drive the economy as well. You know, another point to fight insecurity in any nation or any economy is to also fight dangerous idealism. All funny ideas about religion or what religion is not should be fought openly, should be addressed and be treated openly without any favoritism whatsoever involved. So another key thing is language. You see, language is one of the key unique identifier of any people or any population of humans, okay? And you know, this the more people have different languages, the more or the higher the possibility of division amongst them. And division breeds insecurity. So, you know, for a country like Nigeria, I would have suggested we choose Pidgin as a second official language as against the English language, the British English, that, you know, more or less is seen by the elite or is used as an emblem of recognition for people who are really educated. I personally feel that if we adopt the Pidgin English or the Pidgin language as it is, as a second official language, then it will be some form of leveler, okay? It makes everybody feel, you know, acceptable. You can talk freely, you go to places you are not expected to speak in proper English, even if you don't know how to speak it. Even if you do know how to speak it, then, you know, you can still save it for some other kind of obligation. But, you know, that is how to be more or less inclusive. When we talk about inclusive governance, inclusive organization, or inclusive economic structure, then we should be able to more or less integrate our informal sector to our formal sector. And while all I've said are very key and fundamental, it is also important to address investors alike, because the community of investors must also understand what the new trend of, you know, choosing or analyzing investment. A lot of sophisticated investors right now, or let's say a lot of educated or advanced investors, already have the concept of ESG, and that is the environmental, social, and governance. In the light of this, you know, many of these organizations use these metrics or use these criteria to choose potential investment in line with their social consciousness. So basically, the environmental part of the ESG is considered a criteria of how a company performs as a steward of nature, okay? Like every organization is supposed to, you know, be guided towards more or less sustaining nature, sustaining the earth where we all are, okay? So the social criteria examines how it manages relationships with its employees, suppliers, customers, and the communities where it operates. Unlike those days where investors just invest, just put their money into companies, even though many of those companies are marginalizing their workers, marginalizing the communities where they operate, okay? And the third is governance, and this deals with companies' leadership, the executive structure, the pay, the audit, the internal control, the ISO standard, the international standard organization, you know, called the criteria, meeting all those criteria, meeting global best practices, shareholders' rights, and all the rest you have. So basically, the ESG framework was designed out of a burning need for investors to look beyond just financial reasons when making investment decisions. Today, we must understand that what voting is to electorates, that is, what voting is to people who are voting leaders into power, is exactly what investment is for entrepreneurs and the general business populace. So now, you must see making investment as a vote for or against globalization of market, because in the end, insecurity is a threat to global markets and global sovereignty. So guys,
That will be all for this week's edition of your favorite finance blog, the Monday Money Moves. So up next will be top news for the week. Welcome to the top news section of your favorite finance blog, the Monday Money Moves. Our top news for today is collapse and conquest, the Taliban strategy that seized Afghanistan. So for the very obvious reasons, you know, we are talking about insecurity today and this week inherently. So I chose this topic specifically to reflect on how terrorism or how insecurity can go really fast in any. This does not mean that the Taliban struggle started yesterday. Of course, it's over two decades old. But then, it is an insecurity challenge that has been lingering and lingering on for quite some time. And then people have complained. And you know, it is a pity that there will still be some level of investment that will still be hanging in Afghanistan today. And what is the hope of those investments? What exactly do the investors in that place stand to benefit? And this is why I preached the ESG framework earlier in the discourse, okay? So the ESG, the environment, the social, the governance structure. So investors, or let's say as investors, we must learn to understand the concept of this ESG before we even make attempt to rush into any investment or to even put any dime into any investment. Because at the end of the day, it's not only about financial projections, it's not really a loan, it's not really only about financial expectation, the returns on investment that matters. Also, you want to put your finance, you want to put your hard-earned funds into investments that give you some form of comfort and reliability. And of course, you want some form of investment, you want the kind of investment that gives you comfort, that gives you rest of mind, or let's even say peace of mind. Okay, so the concept of ESG cannot be underestimated or cannot be overestimated. The importance of that framework cannot be overestimated in decision-making process. So I take it again, insecurity for Afghanistan has gone through the roof. Of course, the economy is going to, experience some level of initial collapse, and then it will maybe bounce back along the line if they do the right thing. But I'm very sure right now that from the economic world, people are withdrawing partnerships, relationships, here and there. And I doubt if the Afghanistan currency will still remain a legal tender in international trade transactions. So that will be all for today's episode of your top news from the Favorite Finance blog, the Monday Money Moves. So next will be quote of the week. So guys, welcome to the quote of the week session of your Favorite Finance blog, the Monday Money Moves. So our quote for this week's session is, in the end, insecurity turns all assets into speculative assets. And I take that again. In the end, insecurity turns all assets into speculative assets. So first of all, I'll describe again speculative assets. So speculative assets are assets that, you know, move with the wave of volatility. You know, they don't really have any stability as to say you can make some intelligent predictions here and there, but then they are still assets. A very good example of it is cryptocurrency. I always talk about this. Crypto remains a speculative asset, just like any stock or any share you buy in any company as well. So now the point is, if I say that in the end, insecurity turns all assets into speculative assets, now what is going to happen to whoever owns a landed property in Afghanistan today? You know, we always have this mentality or this opinion that the safest investment is real estate, okay? But then some people will be displaced from their properties as it stands now.
Even in this country called Nigeria, there are so many people who have been displaced from their properties by the menace of the insurgent Boko Haram group. So what are we talking about? Real estate is good, real estate is good, fine. At the end of the day, what kind of investment is safe? If you can be displaced from your investment in real estate, which most people consider the safest investment you can ever put your money into, then at the end of the day, it's really not that safe in the face of insecurity. Any investment that comes face to face with insecurity definitely will burn, more or less run down. Okay, so insecurities must be taken extremely seriously. Insecurities must be tackled effectively and efficiently. Insecurity must never and should never be taken lightly. And that takes us to the closing of today's or this week's episode of your favorite finance blog, the Monday Money Moves. Join me next week as I take you through another informative journey in the world of finance and investment. Thank you for joining.